Abraham Darby, who is just concerned with inventions and inventors, but the distinction between Abraham Darby and his grandson should be very clear. And part of the reason why this unit is so boring, because I think they have combined history with chemistry, with physics, with a little bit of economics and a little bit of politics mixed in. Don't worry too much about it. I just want to give you a brief idea. So Abraham Darby, or Darby Abraham the First, one and the same person, founded the Bristol Iron Company. Now, why is this person important? Because for the first time, he could smelt, or smelting is a process in which you purify iron or the iron ore with coke, and it's a pure type of carbon. It is an efficient use of heat or energy. The first person who could successfully do it using coke as fuel or as heat, as a heat energy source, was Darby Abraham the First, or Abraham Darby is the same person. In the Abraham Darby, that is his grandson. So we have Darby Abraham the First. He founded the Bristol Iron Company, and also the first iron master, or the first person with expertise in iron, and he could successfully smelt iron ore with coke. Now his grandson is the first person to make a bridge over 100 feet over the River Severn. This is in the year 1779. The name itself is very easy to identify. It's also called Iron Bridge, and is still in use today. Now this is designed, or it is built, by Abraham Darby, who was the grandson of Darby Abraham the First, the founder of the Bristol Iron Company. Next, we have to look at a person called Henry Cort. Now, the processes for puddling and rolling in the iron industry. Now, let's look briefly at what is this. This process converts pig iron into wrought iron. Now, the purpose of explaining to you is not to start a new topic on the iron industry, but just to make you identify the invention along with the inventor. So please take notes as you see it on the screen. Next, we have to go to the vertical converter for making steel from iron. The person is Henry Bessemer, or this is also called the Bessemer process. Now, this is a picture of the actual, this is kept in a museum. This is in the Industrial Museum in Kelham Island. As you can see, it's a huge machine. At the moment in the world, there are only three of these left in the world. Now, what is this Bessemer process? It converts iron into steel. Now, this is the whole process of metallurgy. Now, as I said, I don't want to get into science. It's not my subject. Also, you can discuss it with your science teachers. But what we are concerned with is the person, the invention, and the inventor. Next is the open hearth furnace. Now, open hearth furnaces, it takes out most of the impurities out of pig iron, and it's once again it's still producing steel. Now, what open hearth furnaces basically did was it made more efficient use of the fuel. This is also called as the Siemens Martin process. In the book it says William and Frederick Siemens, but don't get confused with that. Now go to the bottom of the page. It says the Great Economic Crisis. So we'll discuss this Great Economic Crisis. This is a very important event in history. And I think we are heading towards this another great economic crisis, which may be even greater than this economic crisis. So let's take pause for a while. Most people, including your parents or your family members, would be a little worried now about money, about finances, about economy, about business, about industry, not just about health. This also happened on a very big scale, on a worldwide scale, in 1929. And this is what we'll discuss now. And in the book, actually, they have compressed it into three short paragraphs. It doesn't really give the full picture. Let's understand the details, what was happening. Now, the Great Economic Crisis, or the Great Depression. I think when you look at the image, this is the image that is used over and over again. This is probably not able to, you know, look after a family properly because there's no money, and the husband is out of a job, and they have no means to look. Now, all this happened due to so many reasons, and I told in history we got to look at the causes. I'll take you to in the History Channel. There are videos on this as well, and I will share it. You got to understand this, what happened. the causes, and maybe later on in your, you can apply it in your own personal life also. How you handle money, how you handle your finance, your savings is also important. Now money, as I said, it's easy to spend. It's very easy. You can spend lakhs and crores even in a single day, in a single moment also. But it's not so easy to earn it. So Great Depression, till now in history, it is the worst economic downturn. That means suddenly it just went down. Take a look at it and just give you a brief highlights of the video.
Lured by fast riches, many Americans went wild in the 1920s, investing beyond their means, often with money they didn't have.
People seriously believed in the 1920s that the stock market and everything else could continue to go up and up and up forever.
And they weren't the only ones. Even banks speculated using depositor funds.
Many banks had been speculating in the stock market, that is, betting the share prices would go up. And when stock prices crashed in the autumn of 1929, hundreds of banks lost a lot of money. Their depositors learned about the bank losses and they naturally feared for their own deposits.
Their lack of confidence quickly turned to panic. By 1931, people flocked to the banks to take their money out.
In normal circumstances, this is fine, because as many people as want their money out are balanced by those people who put their money in. But in times of panic, when people begin to think that the banks are not sound, they all want their money out at once, and the banks simply don't have the money to give it out. That's what's called a bank run, and it often leads to the collapse of the bank.
In 1931 alone, more than 2,000 banks closed. By 1933, 4,000 banks closed. The financial crisis left thousands destitute, many hopeless and hungry, often in despair.
People who have saved up their whole lives preparing for retirement might discover on the eve of retirement that they have no money left at all. The bank failures wiped out tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of individuals.
In 1933, newly elected President Roosevelt took steps to renew confidence in America's banking system. He declared a bank holiday so the federal government could assess the banks and determine which were worth saving through federal assistance. Roosevelt also initiated legislation for depositors' insurance, and in 1933, the Federal Insurance Deposit Corporation, or FDIC, was created.
What this meant was that depositors knew that if their banks failed, they would still get their money out. And needless to say, this encouraged people simply to leave their money in the banks.
Roosevelt's actions restored America's confidence. And by mid-1933, the bank runs were over.
Okay, I think I couldn't have explained it better. So when everyone withdrew their money from the banks in panic, there was virtually no money left, or no liquidity rather, in the banking system. And so it collapsed. It affected one market to another market to another market. For example, during this lockdown, so in the beginning, everyone went to the shop to buy whatever they could buy, and the shops got empty also. Now, this is what happens in Manipur also. When there is a band or a strike, do you see people lining up on the road selling petrol? Why has that happened? Because most on the petrol pumps where petrol is supposed to be there, everyone has bought it out of panic, thinking that they will not get petrol. Just as petrol runs your cars and your bikes and your scooters and your other engines. So money or finance is the fuel that keeps the economy going. And when everyone withdrew it out of panic, this whole system collapsed. And this led to a great economic depression, which lasted for 10 years. We look at purchasing power also. Purchasing power is the amount of cash or income that you have that allows you to buy things. And that's why we are put into different categories. Let's have a simple exercise and then we will wind this up. And this will hopefully make you understand the Great Economic Depression better. Let's compare it, let's say, to a crisis in academics or in studies that has been in there in Kampopi, in Sadhai Hills, where in the hill areas for some time now. You cannot just blame it on one factor. It's very easy to say, oh, students are lazy, students are naughty, they are disobedient, they don't study. That's very easy to say. Or you could blame it on the schools. Schools are not teaching properly. Or you could blame it on the parents also. They're not serious. They don't motivate. They don't take care of their children. That's very easy. It's easy to blame either one. But in reality, it's a combination of so many factors. As schools, as teachers, as school heads, we need to have a system and teach properly. And students also, you need to have that interest and also follow the instruction and study properly. And as parents, they need to just support, whether it is to clear dues or whether it is to buy the basic essentials and books and notes and this and that. And it depends on capacity again. In the cities, for example, you have a rush for private tuitions. Right? Some are paying in thousands. Coaching centers are huge, but it all depends on capacity. Those who can afford, go for it. And those who can afford will do it. But those who can't afford, they have really no choice. So it comes down to this. And let's go back again to the point. Everything comes down to result. But in reality, everyone has to take responsibility. So this applies to finance and economics also. So that's why I said I don't want to rely too much on one book or two books. We have to look at the bigger picture, and I hope you get this also. The fact is that finance also collapsed, banks collapsed, industries collapsed, everything that makes the economy run collapsed, and it was a combination of factors. Now this is perhaps best left in economics. So the lesson here is in history is that when some things collapse, it's easy to blame. But we have to look at not just one factor, but combination of many factors